very much, Eleanor. Right, without further ado, we're going to move on to the next speaker. The next speaker is Malcolm Levene. He is a personal brand coach, and amongst his own list of clients, we have Tom Cruise, Tony Blair, large organisations like Prudential, Deutsche Bank and others. So without further ado, I'll now introduce Malcolm. So if we could give him a round of applause, a warm round of applause.
Good morning. You can say good morning back, actually. Good morning. Very big crowd for a Saturday. Fantastic. So thank you very much for coming. Is this the only facility you have for me speaking? Is that easy to do? If it isn't, we'll do.
You wouldn't have to hold anything.
I don't like holding this. Well, I don't like holding this. Excuse me, sorry. Stuff, but I'm sure I've got some help in case I need it, okay? So,
This is a program I've run for about 10 years called The Power of One, which I use and I run in big businesses, banks, insurance companies, and corporates. The element we're going to work on now is how personal brand affects you and affects your career trajectory and the way that you communicate. Does everyone know who it is? Does anybody know who that is? Alfred Hitchcock, great. So with 1, 2, 3, 4, 7 strokes of the pen, his brand is said. Do we know who he is? Sorry?
John
Snow. For those of you that do look and read the news, I would recommend that you look at Channel 4, John Snow, who runs the news channel. And something about his brand, which is always present. If you look, he wears interesting ties, not ties that you would necessarily like or want to wear, but there's always something quirky about his appearance, and he wears odd-looking socks, rather colourful socks. So his personal brand, his outer brand, the way he presents himself, is always a little bit eccentric, a teeny bit quirky, that always says something about him that others don't say about himself. Does that make sense? That's your outer brand, how you present yourself and how you appear to the world. Anita Roddick, the late Anita Roddick, who created the Body Shop. I met her a couple of times, and she had something about her brand that I would describe as a very functional inner brand. Because we have two brands. We have an outer brand, what people see, and we have an inner brand, only what we see and we know about, but we don't often share with others because we're too shy, too reserved, not sure they'll like it, or not sure it will serve us as well as we'd like it to. Our inner brand is about our values, our level of integrity, how we see the world, what we stand for, and what we won't or don't stand for. And this lady had that in bundles. She started her business when she was living at her parents' house when she was in her late teens, and she collected bottles that her parents would have from medications, from doctors and hospitals, empty them, clean them, and then make potions at home, which she had in rows in her bedroom of the Body Shop's products that became their products. So she started really, really early because she knew who she was, she knew what she wanted to do, and she knew how to do it. So her inner brand was always present. Do we know who she is? Nigella Lawson. Well, apparently, her brand is all about food. Do you know that everything she does on television is produced and scripted? That's not who she really is. She has become that person because that's how she gets more viewers, gets more attention, gets more money, and has the program. So not exactly authentic brand, but a powerful brand because lots of people watch her. The all-important components of the way you package yourself, how you wrap yourself in your attire, your grooming, your presentation, the way you communicate, and the way you converse. Do you all know that each of you have a brand? Great. And as Jeff Bezos, founder of Amazon, his quote is, "Our personal brand is what other people say about us when we are not in the room. Our reputation, how people talk about us." So, if you want, on that note, we make a first impression, whether we're going for a job interview, whether we're interviewing somebody, or meeting somebody for the first time, first date, within 10 seconds. That's when you drop. You make an impression within the first 10 seconds of meeting somebody. And you'll be judged by most people on your appearance, how you appeared in those 10 seconds. Is it not fair? Doesn't really matter, it's a fact. And if you don't take notice of those facts, you will have less of a chance of making a positive impact, and your personal brand will be damaged before you start. I was working with a recruitment consultant who was going to represent the bankers who were earning something like $500,000 a year, huge amounts of money. And the reason he didn't take on one of the bankers that he was interviewing, who was asking to be placed in the city was because this guy's shoes, the heels of his shoes, were so worn down and so in need of repair, that that one thing set him to think, I better look at something else. So he looked at his jacket. His jacket was a bit too worn, hadn't been dry cleaned. He looked at his hair, which needed cutting. And generally, and his nails, by the way. His nails needed cutting and were not true. And on those four or five elements, he decided, I'm not going to represent you. I worked with Bill Clinton's head of production when he was in the White House. And this guy would determine exactly how Bill Clinton and his wife would conduct themselves publicly, in speaking environments, and generally outside of the White House. And what he said about Bill Clinton was, we know, it's the quote, I can say it now, it's years gone by, and I feel safe saying it, we know he's a sleazebag. But when he's in the room, you just don't want him to go. And the reason you don't want him to go is because he has a high level of emotional intelligence. He knows what to say, when to say it, who to say it to, and how to say it. So I can't emphasize enough that your emotional intelligence, your IQ will get you the interview, but your EQ will get you the job. Fact. Cary Grant, an actor that many of you probably won't know or remember, he's been there a few years, but he was considered to be the most glamorous, attractive man in Hollywood. And he, as you can see from appearance, even up to 1940-something or other, looks the business. You need to look the business. And anything about you that doesn't look the business, that will be the thing that you're remembered for, the thing that distracted the other person. Making the effort will get you more attention in the right way. Not making the effort, you're on the wrong side. Shaking hands. Well, the fact is that a handshake can determine both the trajectory of a meeting and the outcome. You are likely to be judged on the way you shake hands. What you're looking for is something between a wet fish and a vice. And if you're not able to judge how you shake hands, you're likely to make a mistake. So you might want to try with a couple of friends or relatives or people you trust. Shake hands and see how it feels. Ask them how it feels to them. Your handshake can determine your personal brand and how you're talking to them. When I was asked to come along by Erlene, I was a bit surprised actually, because so much of my life has been in the business arena. But I'm not used to people as I am in business to a group of people of your age. However, I realise that I've been an entrepreneur for as many years as you are of age, and I have some stuff to share with you and some information to share with you that has helped me and has helped lots and lots of people I work for, lots of people I work with. Yes, I've worked with lots of famous people, but they aren't the people that have informed my life or helped me to be who I think I've become, who I'd like to think I've become. The people that have really helped me are those people that have high level of emotional intelligence, that are authentic, that is real. And the word authentic is important here because the meaning I want to attach to it is not the dictionary meaning that maybe you're used to, which is real, honest. I'm referring to undisputed credibility. Undisputed credibility. And if you want undisputed credibility, I mean, who doesn't, you will need to take some steps between now and when the big step happens to ensure that you are full of credibility. Here are the characteristics that you will need to have in place in order to convey a personal brand that you are both proud of, that you are certain of, that gives you a level of confidence that's up here rather than down here, and to communicate in a way that makes people feel compelled to listen to you, to want to be around you. Those are called soft skills. Those are all soft skills. And these are things I've picked up over the years from loads of people, men and women I've worked with in the corporate arena, television, film, politics, entertainment,
the people I really, really admire and I look up to, and that when you see them, you would too, have all these qualities in place. Smiling is really important. I want everybody to now think of something funny, something you love, something that amuses you, and I want you to smile. Just smile. Right. You can't think of anything negative when you smile. Physiologically impossible. So if your first meeting, you need to smile. I went to a corporate environment last week, and it was a half-circle desk and four receptionists, and it was raining, the day was miserable, the sky was grey, and I wasn't in a great mood. And I went into the office, to the reception area, and the lady that smiled the brightest got my attention. I went over to her. I smiled back, because you do. We mirror people. Does anybody know what mirroring means? Right, so you're a clever crowd. So mirror. So if you want somebody to smile back to you, or even if you want to put yourself in a good mood and help them to be in a better mood, just smile. Because you can't think of anything negative. Yes?
Let's say you want to negotiate a deal.
Right.
So should you smile there, or should you be serious?
Question, so what's your name?
Connor.
Oh, Connor is asking whether you should smile whether you're in a negotiation situation, is that right?
Yeah.
Always smile. There's always a place for smiling. It makes you feel good. It sends a message to your brain that tells you you're happy, even if you're not. And that's not faking it, that's just making it. there's a professor, what's his name? Richard Wiseman, from University of Hertfordshire, who talks about the brain and studies the brain and knows much more about the brain than I. And he would tell you that smiling is just the best thing you can do for your body, for your brain, for your health, for your well-being and your emotional state. And know that they're telling you off for smiling. If they do, they're not the person who will leave. So, does anything there strike anybody as irrelevant, not worthy of attempting to do, or just plain wrong? Everybody agrees. So communication, one message, one communication style. I was speaking to a couple of people from...
I wanted to ask a question regarding excellent manners with regard to culture, because one person's excellent manners may be completely, utterly inappropriate
right.
In your culture situation.
What's your name?
My name's Amy.
Amy's asking about manners in relation to culture and what might be appropriate in Saudi Arabia might not be appropriate in London or New York. It's a very good point, Amy. However, if your manners are honed, if they're polished, if they're emotionally intelligent, you'll use your empathy to understand what is necessary in that particular environment. Or before you go, you'll do some research. I know that I was working with a chap in Citibank who was working in Saudi Arabia. I think it was Saudi Arabia. And apparently in Saudi Arabia, to make eye contact is not considered to be de rigueur. It's not considered to be the most appropriate thing to do at a business meeting. He did his research, and when he went to the meetings, he didn't do that kind of eye contact. He made eye contact as you do normally, without the effort put into making good eye contact. So I think it's a good question. But I would say this to you, Amy, and ladies and gentlemen. Good manners are tantamount to getting yourself a personal brand that you are proud of, that others will talk about proudly, and that will just make you feel good about your life. What about good manners don't you like? Anybody?
Making you perceived as being passive?
No. I don't have, what's your name?
Hassan. No, not good manners as such, but I'm...
Sorry, what's your name?
Hassan. Exaggerated manners, so...
I'm not saying exaggeration. I'm saying please, thank you, excuse me, those kind of what I call everyday generic good manners that get you to a place where you just feel good about you and you're part of the human race. We're here to be nice to each other. We're not here to hurt each other. We're here to be kind, to be nice, to be generous, to be warm, to be compassionate, to be forgiving. And that's something called SQ. My work is underpinned by EQ, emotional intelligence, SQ, spiritual intelligence. I was working with a television presenter and I mentioned to him that my work is underpinned in part by SQ. And he said to me, no, but I don't do religion. And I said, nor do I. SQ has nothing to do with religion. Spiritual intelligence has nothing to do with religion unless you want it to. It has to do with what you're prepared to do. To sacrifice, to do the right thing, and not do the wrong thing. It's that simple. And good manners is part of spiritual intelligence. Does that answer your question, Hassan? I think your point about exaggerating, we don't like to see and to be around anybody that exaggerates. It's too attention-seeking. So you may need to make sure that you have your manners, your etiquette is always in place and well balanced. Yes?
So do you think that is, would you recommend to be more positive, more smiley, rather than to be natural? So if you're in the best mood, then?
If you're in a?
Rather than being natural, so if you're not in the best mood,
right.
Should you behave naturally,
yeah.
Or should you just smile and pretend you're positive?
I don't wake up every morning in the best of moods. But I've learned that optimism, positive thinking and positive action makes me feel better. I do better as a coach, I do better at an interview, I do better at functions like this, and I feel better about my life. I think sometimes you have to fake it to make it. The more you do it, the better you become. It's like going to the gym. You don't lose the suit size after one session, but you get stronger and better as you go more often. So the more you think positively, the more you act optimistically, and the more you show that you are a person that thinks up there rather than down here, you'll get better attention. Does that answer your question? I'm not convinced. Was that a yes?
Yeah, I understand your opinion. I'm not agreeing with you.
Can you tell me what I'm interested? Can you tell me what he doesn't agree with?
Well, because I think that people trust each other when they're natural.
I'm not saying being natural. I'm not saying being unnatural. I'm saying adopt optimism, and it becomes natural who you are, not who you're not. Sorry. Yes. Sorry. It's a good question. Did everybody hear that question? Death in the family. Well, it depends on how important that interview is to you. And it also depends how close the person to you is that has passed and where you need to be. If you need to be close to family because of the passing, then that's your priority. If the job or the interview is very important to you and you really, really need to be there 100%, you need to find a way to attend that interview but to not share your depression with them because they're not interested. The point is, people care about you but not that much. You know what I mean? When many years ago, I was in the retail business and in those days, Tony Blair, Tom Cruise, Emma Thompson, a number of other famous people were clients. And in those days I was working on something, I now describe as the outer brand, how you conduct yourself, how you appear, and how you dress, all that stuff. And, what was I going to say? I'll get back to it in a second, sorry. That was awful, wasn't it? Each of you are going to need, do you know the expression, it says on the tin? Do you know that expression? It was an advert used for a household product called Ronseal, and their claim to fame was, we always do what we say we do on the tin. Does that make sense to you? Do you know what I mean? It's about walking your talk. Are you familiar with that expression? Right. If you aren't walking your talk, you will damage your brand, and you will not feel good about who you are. So it's very important that what you say, the way you communicate, both verbally, physically, emotionally, and otherwise, you always say the right thing at the right time. And you won't get it right every time, but the more you practice, the better you will get. There's a lady called, what's her name, Westwood? Vivian Westwood. Do we know Vivian Westwood? Okay. She's not the nicest lady I've ever met, but she did say something a few years ago which I really liked. She said she would like everybody to learn a new word every week. And I like that. The better your vocabulary,
the better you will communicate. The better you will understand yourself, the better you will be understood. Does anybody there see Ugly Betty?
Yes.
Great. So, have you heard it turned into a movie? Because it's now stopped. Has anybody not seen Ugly Betty? Hands up, so I'll explain to you what it is. It was a TV, American TV show about this lady, who is actually rather lovely looking. She's in Chicago as we speak, so she's not ugly at all. Made ugly for the show. She was a junior member of staff at a very fancy New York magazine. Something like Vogue, not Vogue, but yeah, talking about Vogue. And she was the most unattractive, ill-attired, nappiest person in the group. And everybody around her was beautiful, men were fabulous looking, women were beautiful. She was the odd one out. But she had something that everybody loved and wanted. She had a fantastic inner brand. Fantastic. If you had a problem, you'd go and see her. If you had a question about life, you'd go and see her. If you wanted to know how to feel better about something, you'd go and see her. So her inner brand excelled her outer brand. Does that make sense? She had deep values, family-oriented, and she was just so nice to be around. So her inner brand was fantastic. And if you've not seen it, I would ask you to consider getting the DVD. I think it's on DVD, because I think you'll find it a fun show to watch, and you'll find it interesting. Dalai Lama. Pretty good brand? No? Yes?
Yes.
Yes. Pretty fine human being. You'll be the odd one out if you're smiling, but you'll be the one that's noticed. You'll be the one that's seen, the one that's remembered, and the one that gets talked about in ways that you want to be talked about. And promise you, when you smile, you can't think of anything negative. When I'm crossing the traffic lights where I live, very, very busy road, and I'm a very impatient person, when they're red, I smile. And by the time, like in no time at all, they're green. It just relaxes you, just makes you feel better. Here are the pivotal qualities for you to develop so that your inner brand is as powerful as your outer brand. In fact, perhaps even more so. If anybody disagrees, I'd love to hear from you, or if you'd like to ask questions, I'm happy to answer them if you feel that something there doesn't work for you, or you would like to know more about it. So.
How do you maintain consistency when there are times... How do you maintain consistency with your inner brand? Obviously, at times, you work for 100%.
Right. Hassan's asking how you maintain consistency. I don't want you to maintain consistency, Hassan. I want you to maintain reliability. Reliability means you'll always be here, but you can always go there. Consistency just means you'll always be the same. When you have reliability under your belt, it gives you the facility to go further ahead. Consistency suggests that you'll always be here. How do you maintain reliability? It's called self-discipline. Can you give me an example of how that might be a challenge or when that might be a challenge in your life? Because I think each of us can identify with that question.
Linking back to the original topic of disruptive environments, so if your environment is disruptive, let's say you don't get the best grades or something happens in your family,
right.
That can disrupt your natural
rhythm.
Rhythm. Yeah.
Yes, I agree. So we're going to do a little exercise now, which is in place at the London School of Economics. I wasn't going to do this, but since that question, I'm using my intuition here. And I want you to use your intuition, by the way. And I want to separate IN. Is there a pad? No, there isn't. She'll ask for a whiteboard. IN, okay, IN dash tuition. Intuition. It's everything you've learned, all the mistakes you've made, all the successes you've had, all the experiences is in the back of your mind, like the back of a filing cabinet, waiting for you to listen to it. So I'm using my intuition to do this exercise with you, which is in place at London School of Economics, Tesco,
Harvard University, Cambridge University, and numerous places that I admire and respect. And it's good enough for them, it's good enough for me, and it's going to be good enough for you. So here's how you can actually have more of an emotional equilibrium. Hassan has said, how do you maintain a state of well-being that all is well when all is not well outside? It's when you maintain a state of well-being within. So, I want you to put your pens and papers down, please. Thank you. I want you to sit with your back, so your back is firmly supported by the back of the chair. I want you to have your hands unclasped, or to be resting on your thighs, or that way is good, because that's the meditative position, which means you'll receive. Okay, that's fine, so that would be better. And I want you to breathe consciously. I just want you to breathe consciously. Relax your shoulders. Relax your forehead. Relax your scalp. And when you feel ready, I want the upper lids of your eyes to rest on the lower lids. So they're closed, but softly resting on each other like cushions, rather than forcing them to. Continue to breathe consciously. Relax your shoulders, your chest, your waist, your hips, your buttocks, your thighs, the knees, the calves. Give your feet a bit of a wiggle and then let them rest gently on the floor. Continue to breathe consciously and relax. There's nowhere to go, there's nowhere for you to be. And when you're ready, I want you to breathe deeper than you would normally. Say 10% more than you would normally inwardly. And 10% more than you would normally outwardly. Let everything go. Everything relax. Everything that's worrying is gone. And on the second breath, I want you to breathe in 15% more than you would normally. And 15% more than you would normally on the outbreath. And every outbreath, let more stuff go. This is the last breath. Not the last breath. Sorry to be the last breath. 20% more inwardly. And make a noise if you want to. And 20% more outwardly. Eyes still remain closed, please. And when you feel ready, while breathing consciously, I want you to think of five things in your life that you're grateful for. And one of them could be a cheese sandwich. It really doesn't matter what you're grateful for. Five things you're grateful for, and when you're ready, and only when you're ready, open your eyes. This exercise, there's a science behind the exercise. Did it feel quite nice, by the way? Yeah. It's a nice exercise, isn't it? What it does, it releases something in your brain called dopamine. Do we know what dopamine is? Yeah. It's affectionately known as the happy hormone. Dopamine is affectionately known as the happy hormone. So whether you believe in this or not, I don't really care. Because the science behind it proves the point, which is you feel better about your life. You feel better about life. You feel more confident. You feel happier. And as Hassan said, it will give you that reliability. You can depend on your mood being one that's appropriate rather than not. But you have to do it every day. This is not just a once a week thing. It's every single day. And if you tell me you don't have time, I don't believe you. Because if you do it often enough, it will take 18 seconds of your day to do it. And the only time you can't do it is when you're driving the car, because I want your eyes closed. It also does something else. It brings oxygen to the brain, which gives you more clarity of thought, more relaxation, more positive thinking, and feel better about your life. And the more you do it, the better you get at it. So, listening skills. In my limited experience with people of your age, we don't have kids, there seems to be a challenge to listen.
And I'm going to ask, you know, your ears will never get tired. Just keep on listening and ask good questions. And the way you listen so that you invite the kind of conversation you want to have is you use your emotional intelligence to engage and build rapport. Building rapport is absolutely fundamental in the business world. And as an entrepreneur, you're going to need bundles of rapport building. Humility. Who knows what humility means to them? Not to the rest of the world, to you. Yes, Amy.
Being able to be happy about when I get things wrong.
Happy when you get things wrong, exactly.
And being able to admit that and just assume that it's
right.
You shouldn't try
and be perfect. Right. So Amy's spot on. It's about not being the perfect person, admitting when you get wrong, and in addition to that, forgiving yourself when you get it wrong, because you will get it wrong. You won't get right until you get it wrong, because you'll know what not to do. I think it was Edison, someone like that anyway, he tried, was it Edison? Electricity?
Light bulb,
right, I was right. Better than light bulb, thank you. He said he tried 1,000 times to get it right. And he used those 1,000, maybe it was 1,100 times, as a practice run for getting it right. He never condemned himself for getting it wrong. What he congratulated himself with, he had those experiences that eventually got to the light we have today. So it's about giving yourself permission to get it wrong, take risks, not risks that are too risky, but risks that are calculated. Persevere, never give up. Never, ever give up. You know, I pitched to clients in the UK probably every day. And it's a discipline that I've learned, because if I don't do that, what do I feel? It's my normal. It's what I do every day. In the morning, between 10 and 11, I pitch to clients. Speaking to one of your colleagues before about email, which is how I communicate with business people. And I understand that email is not as used now as it used to be, is that right? And that you use Facebook more than... Oh, sorry, so I'm confused. Hands up who doesn't use email. Great, okay. So your emails need to have an element of your personal brand in the text. People need to know who you are via the way that you communicate with them online and offline. And you need to be the same person online as you are offline. And if those characteristics, some of those characteristics are in place, you will be the same person who you are online as you are offline. Does that make sense? So you need to make sure your spelling's great. Your punctuation is good. The text is well written, easy to read, to the point. And if you think about it like food, I think of, you know, the way I communicate with clients and the way I write my email a bit like food, which I like. So I start off with a tasty appetizer, something to whet the appetite. That will be the first two lines, or one line, or three lines. I then get to what described in America as the meat and potatoes, which is the guts of what I'm saying. And then I always end on a sweet dessert note to make them feel good. And if you're not doing that, start doing it. Oh, not finished yet. I was with a banking executive, actually he's a director of Deutsche Bank, and he was at a workshop that they were running for communication skills and how to engage with clients better. And the speaker was a chap called Sir Stephen Redgrave. Do you know who he is? Sort of sports icon of yesteryear. And he was running the workshop. And he said to the group, someone had left their mobile phone on. He said, do not ever leave your mobile phone on if you're at a meeting, either in-house or out-of-house. It's rude. And I thought that was kind of normal, because I would normally turn mine off. But apparently it's not. So you need to be conscious, empathy-wise, emotional intelligence-wise, what's appropriate for me to do at this meeting? How can I send a message through my behaviours that encourages people to say when I leave, hey, I like that friend, it was good. Or they're going to say, that guy who's left his phone on, that wasn't right. You don't want to say bad things about you, you want them to say good things or nothing. Sorry, Eddie. Right. It's a great question. Great question. Say it a bit louder so everybody can hear. Because it's a great question.
Hello.
This is Amy.
Hi. Nice to meet you all. You look very nice.
Great question. Here's what I would suggest you do. Before the meeting starts, I would suggest you say to the sponsor or somebody who is taking responsibility to bring this forum together exactly what you just told me. That, you're welcome. That's empathy. That's communicating with somebody as a human being. You're saying, this is going on, is it okay? They're not going to say no. But what you're doing, you're alleviating any problem that might occur because you haven't communicated that. Does that make sense?
Thank you.
My wife is a writer. And she's been writing her memoir for about 8 years. And this is, to me, helpful in terms of how you let go. Does everybody know what letting go means? Who's going to tell me what they think letting go is? Letting go is wanting the thing you want, but not being attached to it. Does that make sense? As in, life will go on if I don't get this. I still want it, but I'll still be able to carry on in spite of that. Does that make sense? No? If yes is yes, I want to hear yes.
Yes.
Great, thank you. So, Kate's American, my wife. The book is an American book, it's based in America. And so she wanted an American agent to represent her. And for those of you who don't know, without an agent, you're not going to sell your book. This isn't going to happen. So she contacted, I'm not exaggerating, 100 agents in the United States. And was turned down by every single one. Pretty depressing. This maybe answers Hassan's question in terms of feeling low, getting these messages at UK time, 11 at night, because it's 5 or whatever it is in New York, to go to bed night after night, hearing, not for me, not for me, not for me. So I asked her to let go of the attachment to having an American agent. And how she did that was like this. She removed all of the articles that were associated with the book she was writing off of her desk, so she didn't see them first thing when she walked into her office in the morning. She started to write another book, and she started to contact English, British agents. 6 weeks after the second agent, she only contacted 2 agents in the UK. One of the agents responded, cut long story short, the agent is American. She lives 10 minutes away from where we live. Her brother went to the same university as Kate's brother, and her association in America is with one of the top agents in America, but Kate hadn't contacted him. So she's got exactly what she wanted, and it's not the book yet, close to what she wanted, by letting go. So if there's anything in your life that you can let go of, you will have a better chance of getting more of what you want and less of what you don't want. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Great. Thank you. Yes.
Sometimes I find being disrupted, acting disrupted in a sort of disruptive sort of mindset, can come across as like against convention.
Right.
That can come across as maybe a bit rude to some people or a bit abrasive. How would you manage that? Those two, in my mind, opposing forces.
Well, I've been disrupted for most of my business life. the information that I impart and that I teach and that I help people in the business world is not commonly thought of as de rigueur or acceptable. Because I'm teaching soft skills. And what's your name, by the way?
Jiva.
Jiva. How do you spell that?
It's
Jivan, sorry. My recommendation, Jivan, is you seem like a nice guy, you seem articulate, and you have a nice personality. You need to stay with what you believe and what you value, even if it's disruptive. Because if you don't, if you give in to what you think they want, or what they don't want, you will lose part of who you are. Is what you want to do disruptive in ways that will help others?
Yes. Definitely.
Right. So you need to embody something called self-belief. Self-belief. And what happens is this, and there's a skill called NLP. Does anybody know what NLP is?
Neuro-linguistic programming. I've dipped my toes in the water of neuro-linguistic programming since it was... I've got 2 minutes. I'll end with this. The inventor, creator of NLP, is a chap called Richard Bandler. Deeply flawed, but brilliant. And he said something at the last conference I went to that stayed with me. You get more of what you focus on. So if you focus on what you don't want, you'll get more of it. If you focus on what you did wrong, you'll do it wrong again. It's really that simple. The brain is a very, very simple machine if we know how to use it. So just focus on what you want more of, what you do well, and what you're proud of. Now, there is one more thing. Have I got a minute? I've got to go in there, okay. So this is a skill you can use at any interview. And science supports the fact that this works. I still use it when I'm feeling a bit emotionally wobbly. We assume that this is a door. I'm going to be walking to a door speaking to a banker who's left-brained, as in everything has to be just so. And I'm feeling a bit less well than I'd like to. I smile. I breathe 3 times into my abdomen. And that's important because you bring oxygen to your brain. And I think of 3 things I'm proud of. And then you step into the room, and that's what you're taking to the room. You're taking self-belief, confidence, a buoyed atmosphere, and you'll be the person that that person, in the first 10 seconds, wants to know more about. And you always stand tall, with your head held high, and you smile. And it doesn't matter if somebody sees you, they don't care. This is about how you take care of yourself, so you do the best job you can do. And apparently, I'm finished.